presentation.
Okay, thanks, Bronson. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to talk about the highly efficient organic light emitting diode based on dendrimer and ternary exciplex. An OLED is an organic layer which is between two electrodes and convert the electricity to light. They have two main applications. One of them is a display and the other one is lighting. In display, we usually use the vacuum deposition because it gives us the high resolution pixeling. But for lighting, we prefer to use solution process, which decreases the price. And one of the reasons lighting couldn't be so popular in the market because of the high price of the fabrication. The process of the electroluminescence in the OLED is as follows. We first have an injection of electron and hole from electrode. And after that, discharge transfer inside the organic layer and they form exciton. This exciton has a lifetime. And after that, this exciton recombine and produce light. To have an efficient electroluminescence, we need to optimize all of this step. So one of the parameters which shows the efficiency of the OLED is external quantum efficiency, which depends on a couple of parameters. The first one is charge balance efficiency, which depend on the dynamic of charge, including charge injection, charge transport, and shows how many percentage of the injected light form exciton. The second part is the exciton formation efficiency, which is 25% for fluorescence material and 100% for phosphorescence material or TADF. The other one is PLQY. PLQY indicate how many percentage of spin allowed decay radiatively. These three first parameters regarded as an internal quantum efficiency. The last parameter, which is more important in this part for us, is outcoupling. If we have 100% internal quantum efficiency, due to the different refracting index of the layer, the outcoupling usually is something between 20% to 30%. So to have a high EQE, we use lots of technique. One of those technique is using exciplex as a host or exciplex as an emissive layer. What is the difference between exciplex and exciton? In exciton, both electron and hole is in the same type of material. But in exciplex, electron and hole is in different type of material. What does it mean? If they are in the same material, the energy, the emissive energy of the exciton depend on the ionization potential and electron affinity of the, for example, hole transport layer. When we go to the exciplex, the energy estimated by the ionization potential of the donor and electron affinity of the acceptor. And actually we have a slightly more energy decrease from it, which is the stabilization energy. So we expect the energy of exciton being lower than the energy of exciplex being lower than the energy of the exciton. It shows us how we can recognize exciton in experiment. So if we have two material and we blend them, we expect we have a lower energy for exciplex, so we should see a shift in the emission to the higher wavelengths. And actually, the peak for the exciplex is always more broadened than the component, which arises from the existence of various emissive species in exciplex. The wave function of exciplex is a blend of the charge transfer state and resonance exciton. But the first part is usually negligible, so we just usually talk about the charge transfer state. So why we use exciplex? What is the advantage of exciplex? The first thing about exciplex is that exciplex has a bipolar property. Having a bipolar property, give a if we have a single unipolar property, like if you use just whole transport host, so we expect whole transport much better than the electron, and the recombination zone expected to be a narrow zone close between emissive layer and electron transport layer. And same for electron transport layer. So in this case, if recombination zone being a small area, we expect having a higher roll-off because of the accumulation of the exciton and charge in one place. But when we use ambipolar, the recombination zone broadens all over the emissive layer. So we expect having a lower roll-off for the ambipolar host. The second advantage of the exciplex is the exciplex usually shows TADF characteristic, which decreases the device operation voltage. We want a high EQE, but this EQE should happen at the lowest voltage because we want to reach to the high EQE with the minimum of the energy consumption. So that's important to decrease the driving voltage. For decreasing the driving voltage, we should decrease the barrier. And for decreasing the barrier, we need to decrease the singlet energy of the host. Another thing is that the energy of the host, the triplet energy of the host, should be higher than the triplet energy of the guest, because we don't want to have to lose energy. So when singlet energy should be low and triplet energy should be high, it means that exactly TADF. So TADF is a quite good choice for being used as a host for emissive material. But one of the problems of TADF is that it needs a complicated design and synthesize. For exciplex, we don't have such a problem. We just can use some commercial donor and acceptor and mix them and have a TADF characteristic. Here, we use empty data as donor and OXT7 as acceptor, and blend of both of them as an exciplex host for this red dendrimer, and TMPYPB as an electron transport layer. So at first, we check the photophysical properties of the material. First, we check the absorption of component and the blend of empty data and OXT7. The absorption of the blend is the mixture of the absorption of single component, which means that for exciplex, we don't have any interaction in the ground state. One interesting is that if you look at the empty data OXT7 and dendrimer, the absorption is quite similar to the empty data OXT7, which is due to the low amount of the dendrimer. We use 2%, 2 weight percent of dendrimer for our devices. After that, we check the PL. If you look at the PL spectra, we can see that empty data and OXT7, and when we blend them, we can see the shift to the higher wavelengths, which prove the formation of exciplex, and it has a broadened featureless peak, which shows the existence of different species in the blend. When we blend it with the dendrimer, almost all of the energy transferred to the dendrimer. But when we check the excitation emission map, we can get more data here. The first one is excitation emission for the empty data OXT7. By excitation less than 330 nanometer, which is the place that we have excitation for both OXT7 and empty data, a small peak at lower wavelength is clear, which belongs to the OXT7. After annealing the film of empty data OXT7, this peak becomes much more stronger, which shows the phase separation between empty data and OXT7. At excitation higher than 330 nanometer, which there is just absorption by empty data, we can see a peak from empty data here. By adding dendrimer, 2% dendrimer, for an annealed film, the emission from the component decrease a lot. But for the annealed one, still the emission from the OXT7 is clear here. For higher excitation, 340 nanometer, the emission from empty data is not as clear as here. So it shows that the miscibility of the dendrimer in empty data is quite high. For higher concentration, 8% and 24%, we can see that the shoulder in the left side decrease, and for 24%, there is no more shoulder. To realize what happened, we check the microscopical image of the surface with different concentration. So that's the formation of crystal for low concentration of dendrimer is quite clear. And for 24%, there is no crystal. There is also one more point here. 24%, if we don't have any crystal for 24%, it comes from the high solubility of the dendrimer, which avoid the crystallization of the empty data of the OXT7. Another point is that this crystallization happened irrelevant on the substrate. So for P.PSS or PVK or silicon or glass, in all cases, we have such a river-like crystallization. Before fabricating the device, we also check the mobility of the whole mobility of the layer. For empty data, that's 10 to the minus 5. When we blend it with OXT7, it decreased to order of magnitude, which is due to the disruption effect of OXT7 on the pathway of whole transport through empty data. However, after annealing, the mobility increased and reached to the 10 to the minus 6. So it comes from the phase separation again. When we have a phase separation, we have some pathway for empty data, so hole can easily transfer through empty data. By adding dendrimer, it changed slightly, but not really much. the mobility. That's in spite of the single host. For single host, we have a couple of presentation which shows that after adding a little amount of the dendrimer of the phosphorescent material, the mobility dropped a lot. And that was due to the trap role of the dendrimer. But here, the ionization potential of dendrimer and empty data are quite similar. So they don't play the role of the trap. The only the reason for difference between the mobility here is due to the increasing of disorder of empty data by increasing the amount of the dendrimer. And we can see for quite high percentage of dendrimer, the whole mobility of annealed and unannealed one is quite similar in spite of the low percentage. So after that, we fabricate devices. We can see from the IVL characteristic that the turn-on voltage is quite low. It's around 2.6. That's so close to the theoretical amount for the red emissive material, which believe that that's based on the wavelengths of the emission. Also, high efficiency red OLED we can see that we have a high EQE for the annealed OLED around 14.6, which is quite high, and the efficiency is higher for the annealed one relative to the unannealed devices. Also, for the annealed devices, for unannealed devices, we have a small peak in lower wavelength, which is from the empty data OXT7 exciplex. To show the advantage of the exciplex over a single host, we compare the empty data OXT7 blend with just empty data or TCTA as a host for dendrimer. That's obvious that the turn-on voltage is lower and the driving voltage is lower for exciplex, and actually the efficiency is higher and the roll-off is quite low also relative to in the range of 1 to 1,000 candela per square meter. That's important when we work with exciplex as a host to check the devices without the dendrimer, because the dendrimer emission is quite high. So we don't know really what happened inside the device. But if we fabricate device without the dendrimer, it can give us some more data. When we fabricate devices with empty data OXT7 for annealed and unannealed one, again, the turn-on voltage is quite low. And for the annealed devices, the efficiency reached to 6.2%, which is quite high. None of this material is emissive material. And such efficiency, which is more than the fluorescence material, shows the TADF characteristic of the empty data OXT7. But the most interesting thing about this device is the EL spectra. If we look at the EL spectra of the unannealed, the red one, and annealed one, we can see a big change for annealed devices relative to the unannealed one. We have a shoulder in lower wavelength for annealed device. So we suspected it might be from the formation of exciplex between empty data and TMPYPB. So we fabricate devices with the empty data and TMPYPB as an emissive layer and check the EL, and we realize that that peak is exactly from empty data TMPYPB. which proves the formation of ternary exciplex. So one exciplex between empty data and OXT7 and the other one empty data and TMPYPB. So what's happened that after annealing, we have a exciplex between empty data and TMPYPB? If you look at this diagram, without annealing, the amount of the empty data in contact with TMPYPB is quite low. But after annealing, when crystallization of OXT7 happened, more empty data has contact with TMPYPB. So we expect to see the emission from empty data TMPYPB exciplex. And we can see that here from the Dektak profile that when we check the film, we have a quiet raw film, and after the position of the other layer is still that's rough, but much lower than the neat emissive layer. It gives us some suggestion that such a structuring might be the reason of the higher efficiency of the anneal device. So this structuring increased the outcoupling. Actually, we should remember that also the mobility of the anneal device is higher. So the mobility and outcoupling could be the reason for increment of the efficiency after annealing. If you look at here, the surface of the unannealed device is quite smooth. But if you look at the annealed one, we can see that that's not really a smooth like the unannealed one. And CIE coordinate for devices with dendrimer, they are quite similar. But for devices, for neat exciplex, we can see that we have a shift in the CIE coordinate. And we can see the color become a little bit greenish. We summarize the performance of the devices here. And also, we measure the PLQY and add the data here. Just look at one of the data. The PLQY of the empty data OXT7 for annealed one. The PLQY is almost 12%. The EQE is 6.2%. So EQE is more than 50% of the PLQY. If you remember, that's at the beginning, we mentioned that the PLQY, the outcoupling usually, because of the outcoupling, the EQE usually is just 20 to 30% of the PLQY. And 50% seems a little bit odd here. And we can see it for other data. So at first we suspect maybe the measurement has a problem, measure it a couple of times. We use some standard, but all of us give us the same result. And when we check other paper for exciplex, we see it for other paper, they have the same issue in a couple of paper. For example, here, the PLQY is 27% and EQE is 14%, which is more than 50% again, more than 50% of the PLQY. But there is no comment on such an inconsistency. So we believe that it comes from the different pathway of the formation of excitone or exciplex with photoexcitation or electroexcitation. In photoexcitation, excitone form in donor and acceptor, and after that they move between the interface of donor and acceptor. They should transfer to the charge transfer state, and after that they emit. In the case of the injection, electron move through the donor and hole move through the acceptor. And when they reach to the interface, they form the charge transfer state and they recombine produce light, which is more effective than the formation of charge transfer state through the exciton. In the final part, we measure the performance of the devices for 8% dendrimer. For 8% dendrimer, the PLQY is almost 50%. If you look at here, the EQE is 10%. So in this case, it makes sense. So it seems that the crystallization of OXT7 has an effect on the inconsistency between PLQY and EQE. So in conclusion, we see improvement of the device performance after annealing, and we shows that the formation of ternary exciplex after annealing and crystallization of OXT7. We believe that the improvement of the efficiency is due to the improvement of the charge mobility and outcoupling, and inconsistency between EQE and PLQY was due to the different pathway of photoexcitation and charge injection. At the end, I would like to thank Professor Paul Baer, my supervisor, Dr. Paul Shaw, and Dr. Almontes Pivricas, and thanks from all of you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure we would all join everyone in thanking our speaker. So do we have any questions? Open up for questions from the audience. You need to unmute your microphone if you want to ask some questions. I guess if there's no questions from the audience, maybe I'll quickly ask. So the structure that she showed, you kind of had the sketch with a quite rough film layer and kind of showing the crystallization causing, so this here as you anneal it. I guess the charge transport behavior would be quite complicated in here when you have a geometry like this. You know, you kind of take, imagine going from top to bottom, you take a pathway where you run through some of these sort of needle-shaped features or kind of down in between them. When you were studying the charge transport, did that affect what you looked at in terms of the mobility, or do you think that's something that you were measuring or accounting for, or do you know much about the impact of that structure on the way that the charges would be moving through that system?
We have some idea about it. The charge mobility here, we mentioned that one of the reasons could be for the charge mobility could be the different pathway here. For example, in the first case, in this case, if hole want to transfer in between, there is some OXT7 in between, which make it more difficult for hole to transfer. But in the other case, that's much easier if we want to do the measurement. Another thing for measuring the mobility, having a quiet, a smooth surface is desirable. If we have a rough surface, it has some effect. Because, for example, if we use misty leaf, the pathway which electron move to go to the insulator, that's different than the reality. Because we have a rough surface, so maybe it's just transfer less than the reality. So in measurement, it might have some effect.
Yeah. Thank you. Did we have any other questions from our audience? Okay. If not, then thank you very much for an interesting presentation. We only have one speaker this month, so that's the end of our session. As usual, if you are interested in giving a seminar at this event, then please get in touch. I'd be very happy to receive an abstract. If not, then thank you, everyone, and we will be back again next month. So see you later.
Thank you.